thank y'all for watching. The Sunday school lesson from Holy Trinity. We begin the church with the pastor, the very fine pastor, Mason Baker Bridges. This morning, our Sunday school lesson is Weeping, God's Just Lesson, Luke 16:19-31, reading Luke 16:19-31, John 5:24, and 30. Place, probably Perea. Going in text, son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received thy good things, and likewise Lazarus' evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Luke 16:25. The fact, preparing the lesson, fact, to learn some key details about what happened after death. It's going to show us that how Lazarus was welcomed into the bosom of Abraham, and how the rich man lifted his eyes up in Hades or hell. The principle to understand that the meaning of the story will open our eyes to understand our other truth. Application to be alert to the fact that our lives and our beliefs have end results. Introducing the lesson, while not all agree, it seems the Lord Jesus is telling this story not as a parable, but as a true account. We are captured by the story because it hits us where we live and makes us wonder about many things. Develop the lesson. The tales of two men, Luke 16:19-23. We have no idea whether the rich man appreciated his wealth. We are not told about the faith of either man directly. The rich man's lack of faith would surface later. Each man had the opportunity to believe God, love him, and to obey him. And I'll put a pinpoint right there because in this day and time, we have the opportunity to believe in God. We have the opportunity to love God. We have the opportunity to obey him. But a lot of times we got a reprobated mind or in hard-headedness that we don't want to obey God. We don't want to love him. We don't want to believe him. But we want him to come to our rescue when we call for him. But for God to come to your rescue, when you call for him, you need to believe in him, you need to love him, and you need to obey him. I guarantee you, if you're doing those three things, God won't have no problem opening up the windows of heaven. God won't have no problem blessing you, that you won't have room enough to receive. You'll be walking in abundance because you're doing things that's pleasing. Because if you believe him, if you believe in God, that's pleasing him. If you love him, you know that's pleasing him. And Lord knows that if you're obeying him, that, you know that's pleasing him. So finally, both men died. The way the Lord Jesus reported this is a beautiful. It's beautiful. Lazarus died and was carried by the angel into the bosom of Abraham. Luke 16:23. When the rich man died, his body was buried, and probably with all the cares and attention such a person might have arranged for and might have expected. Unfortunately, he opened his eyes after dying to find himself in hell. No human being would have told a story like this. We would probably say, well, maybe he made it into heaven. I hope he did. But Jesus revealed the rich man did know the status of both him and Lazarus. He knew who Abraham and Lazarus were. He knew who Abraham and Lazarus were. And so, I put a pinpoint right there. That the rich man knew. Now the Bible didn't say, I put a pinpoint right there because it brings out the point that It says a rich man knew where Abraham and Lazarus was, but it didn't say anything that Lazarus knew where the rich man was, because that even though Lazarus was done wrong, if Lazarus would have found out that the rich man with his eyes in hell, it might have caused some anguish or some sadness. And you know, when you go to paradise, there's no sadness. It's just everything pleasant. So, you know, it's pleasant over there. And so, and also by the rich man knowing where Lazarus was, as I went on in the story, in the study of the text, that might have brought on more anguish and hardship or whatever towards the rich man, because he had to reminisce now. Lazarus up there in the bosom of Abraham, not suffering, he in a comfort place. Now I'm down here, amen, needing Lazarus. Now Lazarus needed something. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me hold up right there. Okay, so now we know the rich man knew where Lazarus was. So go back to the rich man and the poor man. Study the text, Luke 16, 19, and 21. That last part of that paragraph, it says, he regretfully feasted on the finest food in great abundance. He would no doubt have been the envy of many people. They let you know that this rich man had a table that spread with the finest food and had abundance. It says he had abundance of great food, and he was so selfish, so mean, so stingy, that he wouldn't even give Lazarus some crumbs. Now, if he had abundance and great food on his table, you know he had a whole lot of leftovers. You know he had some meat left on some bones somewhere or another. But he wouldn't even give Lazarus no leftovers. And it goes on in that third paragraph, says to be placed where many people pass by, including by the gate of wealthy men's property. That's talking about when Lazarus was laid at the rich man's gate. And it talks about how Lazarus didn't ask to be at the table. Lazarus didn't ask to come in the house. Lazarus didn't ask to eat from the fine silverware or the plate or drink out of the fine glass. Lazarus just wanted to just the crumbs from his table. And the rich man could not even honor their request of Lazarus. That makes me know the rich man was stuck in his ways, and it was all about him. And in this lifetime, it ain't about us. Amen. God blesses us to be a blessing to other people. And when you got an abundance and you don't want to share it, or you don't want to be a blessing to the poor, amen, you're not pleasing God. And if you, for the Bible readers and the scholars out there, that's how the deacons, Stephen and all the deacons, Stephen and the deacon board, the disciples, that's how they came into play, because Stephen was wanting to feed the poor. And so God mission is to be a blessing to the poor. And so when you got abundance and you sitting there, you mean and stingy, don't want to share nothing with nobody, don't want to get nobody a slice out of your loaf of bread, you're not pleasing God. And you got so many people in this day and time acting like the rich man, but they ain't rich, but they got enough to be a blessing to somebody else, but they don't want to be a blessing. And I want you to know at this right now that if you go to church and you're on some kind of board, or you're on some kind of auxiliary, that if you think you're a leader but you're not being a blessing to the kingdom of God by blessing the poor, amen, you're not pleasing God. All the work you're doing could be in vain simply because you're mean and you're selfish. And you see a whole lot of people that go to church. I got mine, so you get yours. Amen. You see a whole lot of people that come to church not concerned about nobody else's well-being. They all about them. As long as they got on their nice clothes, nice shoes, nice hat, carrying their nice purse, driving their nice vehicle, got their nice home, they ain't concerned about nobody else. But if you got Christ in you, you ought to be concerned about somebody inside yourself. Amen. Because imagine if Jesus was selfish. Imagine if Jesus, amen, and when he came here, he's like, no, I ain't fooling with y'all, because every time I'm dealing with y'all, every time I try to do something good, somebody always, they always trying to kill me. They always trying to do something to me. But no, Jesus wasn't selfish. Amen. Amen. When Jesus took two little fish and five loaves of bread, he fed 5,000 men, not two, the children, amen. Jesus wasn't selfish. But, amen, and say you're a Christian. A Christian is meaning being Christ-like. Now, if you're saying you're a Christian and you're not even trying to bless the poor or help the needy, amen, you might need to take that word Christian out of your vocabulary, because you're not being Christ-like. Christ-like is helping others, amen. Not pouring water on a drowning man. Not putting your foot on somebody's neck when they're already down. It's helping somebody up. That's what we ought to be doing. Weeping God's justice. Amen. Weeping God's justice. That was the title of the Sunday school lesson. Weeping God's justice. And it goes on to say, being full of sorrows. Talking about Lazarus in that third paragraph. Being full of sorrows reveals a condition both painful and likely infection. And see, the rich man, I'm pretty sure by the man being rich, somebody, his servants or somebody had to tell him about Lazarus. Somebody had to tell him about Lazarus had sores, that Lazarus wasn't feeling well. Like, Master, can we just give this man some bread? Can we just give this man some wine? Can we help this man out? Because his body is full with sores. Have you ever seen, went by the hospital or seen somebody that was confined to the bed that have bed sores? That's not a good sight. Amen. And Lazarus had sores on his body, and the rich man, it didn't even favor the rich man, because if it did favor the rich man, he would get Lazarus some help. So the rich man, even though he didn't get Lazarus no food off his table, no wine or none of that, he didn't even get Lazarus, he didn't even send help Lazarus away. All that riches he had, he could have had somebody get Lazarus some help. Or he could have said, well, even though I ain't going to feed you, Larry, I ain't going to give you no crumbs off my table, I will do this for you. I will get some of my help first to get you off of my front door and get you some help to the doctor or whatever. But he wouldn't even do that for Lazarus. I'm pretty sure it would not have hurted him one bit financially to get Lazarus some physical help from a doctor. But that's how mean and sensitive he was. He didn't even care nothing about Lazarus' well-being. Not at all. And so, the Bible would say, no, what profit of the man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Amen. And so, all y'all that play the lottery hoping to hit big, amen. What profit of a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Amen. Don't lose your soul. Don't lose your soul by being selfish. Don't lose your soul because you drive an $80,000 or $90,000 car. Don't lose your soul because you live in a split level house. Don't lose your soul because you stay in the best neighborhood or in the gated community. Don't lose your soul, amen, because of all you forget about where you done came from. No, you didn't have a pot. No, you didn't. Oh, I tried to rewrite that. You know you didn't have. Oh, man. No, you didn't have the best stuff as you was growing up, but all of a sudden now you don't ride because your credit report is good, because you got nice clothes to put on, you got more than one thing to pull out of your wardrobe. Don't get beside yourself, amen, because the same people you stepping over, you might have to go back and be like a rich man, amen, and ask for some help. We cannot forget about that. Don't, how that phrase used to go, as you go up the ladder, you pass the people, the same people you pass, you might have to go right back down. Amen. Pass them again. Amen. So don't get beside yourself. Amen. A whole lot of times, people people to get inside and say, you know, the old people, you say, you get too big for your britches. Don't get too big for your britches. Amen. Don't get beside yourself. Always keep focused. Always keep God in your view. And I guarantee you, you can make it. And it says the mental image word drawn from this brief description certainly incites sympathy for this man polite. And it would seem like there was somebody, amen, it don't say, but I'm just speculating here. I mean, it would seem like from the rich man that it would have been somebody from that rich man camp who would have snuck Lazarus some food, some water, something to help him out. And so sometimes people become as their master. You know, they're not so mean and stingy and selfish. Sometimes the workers come to, being the same way. So I would have never gone out and just put on like, why didn't any of the servants of the rich man help Lazarus? Think him something. Amen. Lazarus, it goes on, but Lazarus was not asking to be admitted to the rich man's house to be sitting at the table, which I said a while ago. It says, and it's talking about how that, that whole paragraph, it talks about how the dogs, on the comfort that Lazarus had, that when the dog came and licked his sores, amen. And so that means when the dog to come and lick Lazarus' sores, it had to have some kind of, to us, not a good smell to it. And that might have helped Lazarus out, you know, about a dog licking his sores. The same way, like, sometimes I think you got a real bad burn or you got a real bad infection, you in the hospital or something, they put a baggage on you to eat that dead skin. Amen. So, you know, maybe the dog was a blessing to Lazarus by Invictus soul. Gave him some kind of comfort. Then it goes on, and then fifth paragraph had talks about Lazarus was righteous. Not because he was poor, but because he depended on God. Whatever you do in this walk of life, depend on God. Amen. There's nothing wrong with every now and then leaning on a friend. Ain't nothing wrong with every now and then leaning on a family member. Let your ultimate dependence be on God, because God will never let you down. God got unlimited resources. We only can do so much, amen, but God can do the impossible. God can do what we cannot do. So a lot of times we get our focus on man when our focus should be on God. So put your focus on God like Lazarus did, and depend on God. Depend on God. If you like being due, depend on God. Get behind in your car payments. Depend on God. Seems like your job is not doing good. They cut it back. Depend on God. Amen. Seems like you might not be where you think you ought to be at in life. Just depend on God. The Bible says, in all thy ways, acknowledge the Lord, and he'll direct your pathway. And if you do that, scripture, I guarantee you, you're going to be pleasing God, because you're acknowledging him, and he directed, and you asking God, God, order my steps, so I can follow the order that you give me. But don't ask the Lord to order your steps. Then when he give you an order, you don't go along with the order. Amen. You got to go along with the order. Yes.
So you want to repeat that, or you want to say it, you want to say it again. In order, in other words, in order to get closer to God, you got to be obedient. Whatever God directs you to do. And sometimes, like, if you're not in Christ, you can't hear what Christ is telling you to do. It might have been that somebody was trying to tell him to do something for Lazarus, but he didn't hear. He didn't hear. And, you know, the word says, he who has ears, let him hear. But when we turn a deaf ear to God because of the things of this world that we desire, then we cannot hear the voice of the Lord.
Amen.
We have to turn our ears to God. I remember Mama David anointing people's ears so that they can hear the word. And when you can hear the word of God, that can change your life.
Amen.
If he had just heard, gave a listening ear to God while Lazarus was out there at that fence,
amen.
It would have been a total different story. And it is trying to encourage us that we need to hear somebody besides the things that we want to hear. So when we pray, we need to pray that God will let us. I pray for him to let me hear the right things. Because we can hear all kinds of things and turn it around and do whatever we desire. But until we hear,
all right,
for thus says the Lord, then we're going to stay on that wrong road. Going to stay on that road. We're not going to be where God wants us to be. So we got to set our minds, our hearts, our desires on what thus says the Lord.
Amen. All that you're saying will preach. Amen. All right, Luke 16 and 23. Let's talk about that last paragraph. It says, as a rich man closed his eyes in death, he immediately opened them in torment. A lot of times people ask me what happened after death, and I used to give them three or four examples. The four examples I used to give them were Lazarus. They said when Lazarus died, he got carried away to the bosom of Abraham. The second one, the thief on the cross, when Jesus said today, when the thief asked Jesus to remember him, he said today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. And the next one, when Paul said, when I take my last breath, I'll be present with the Lord. Then the rich man, now the rich man, when he closed his eyes, says, immediately he lifted his eyes up in torment. Amen. So if you wonder what's going to happen after death, amen, you live right. Amen. Live right and don't take no chance, man. It's a halfway line that you're going to go somewhere and just rest and sleep and whatever, and you ain't going to feel nothing. Because if Jesus told the people on the cross today that I shall be in paradise, that means he's in a pleasant place. If Lazarus in the bosom of Abraham, that means he's in a pleasant place. If Paul said, when I take my last breath, I'm going to be in paradise. Amen. That's a pleasant place. So if you live right, and you're trying your best to live right, when you take your last breath, you say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Come on up. I'll make you rule over many. When you do your last breath, he said, well done. Amen. That way you know you'll be somewhere in a pleasant place, somewhere in the presence of God. And so don't let when you take your last breath that you live, be like a rich man. You lift your eyes up in torment. Amen. A lot of times, people waiting at the last minute. Well, I got time. No, you don't have time. We don't hear about too many people dying accidentally there. They know that, well, we don't know when we're going to die, but you kind of know if you got some kind of sickness, but I'm talking about that. If you're in a car wreck or any kind of something, we don't hear about trees falling on people's houses and they get killed, people in car wrecks, motorcycle wrecks, or just accidentally there. We don't know, drive-by shooting. We don't know when is our last time. So that's why our business got to be fixed, not getting fixed. We can't be packing up, getting ready to go. We got to be packed. We got to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. If I close my eyes in the next 5 seconds, I'm going to be present with God. Amen. So there ain't no time to be holding no grudges. There ain't no time to be having no backbiting spirit. There ain't no time to be having no nasty attitude. It's not no time to be selfish. It's not time. Amen. It's all about me. There's no time for that stuff. Amen. If you want, amen, when you close your eyes for the last time, then you say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen. And so we got to make sure our business is right with God. So when we close our eyes for the last time, it's going to be all right. But if you do close your eyes for the last time and you in torment, ain't nobody's fault but yours. Amen. If I die and I lift my eyes up in hell, I can't blame Pastor Bridges. I can't blame none of the sisters in here. There's nobody's fault but mine. I bet.
back in the 80s, I think when Sister Maggie Ingham used to sing a song, I got a Bible to read. If I don't read that Bible, it's nobody's fault but mine. Amen. So it ain't nobody's fault. It ain't even God's fault. But God give you the choice to live right, to follow Him. But if you disobey that, ain't nobody's fault. God don't send you to hell. You send your own self to hell. God, that's how much God loves us. That, you know, sometimes you can pray, well, God loves us so much, why He sent us to hell. God don't send you to hell. You send yourself by not doing His will. Amen. If we just follow Him and do what He asks, He said, you ain't got nothing to worry about. I'll wait on you hand and foot. You call me, I'll come to your rescue. That's all that we got to do. But no, we want to do what we want to do. Amen. We want to have a good time. Let the good times roll. And when the devil says, yeah, come on and let the good times roll with me. But when the devil get through with you, he gonna hang you out to dry. Amen. That's the only thing the devil, he'll paint a pretty picture. He give you a quick feel, but when they get through with you, you in jail, your faith is, you don't have no kind of faith, amen. Your life is reckless. You don't know how to call on God. You don't know how to depend on God. That's why I tell people, get right now, amen, with God. Get right with God. That's what we need to do, and do it now. Amen. That way, when your way get hard, my God, when your back is up against the wall, you know how to call on Him. You know how to depend on Him. But if you live in hell on every hand, amen, mama can pray for you all she wants to, but it's a time to come that you got to call on God. It's going to be time to come that you got to go down on your bended knees and cry out to God. Amen. Mama can cry for you only so long. The pastor can call and counsel you for only so many times, but you got to go down on your bending knees and call on the Lord. And He'll come. But you got to depend on Him and live right. For you won't be like a rich man. Lift your eyes up in hell. And it goes on to say, not only he could see where he was, but he could also see where Lazarus was. See, what does this mean? That the lost can see what they have missed is an open question. My. I know I hit on that wall though. That would be something. If you died, and you went to hell, then God said, no. I told you in the word that's going to be anguish, gnashing of teeth, sorrow. And a part of that sorrow, I got to let you see what you missed. And here I am in hell looking up, seeing Pastor Bridges, these wonderful sisters in heaven having a good time, eating from the tree, that bear fruits forever, on the streets of gold, going in and out the pearly gates, seeing them fellowshipping with Jesus and the disciples or whoever. Amen. Here I'm sitting there down in hell in anguish and torment because all I had to do was just follow Jesus. Amen. As my Lord and Savior, I could have been doing what they do, but now I'm down here, amen, in anguish and in torment. That would torment me. Amen. So that's going to even make me just even think about that, Pastor, because even try to walk, talk, and live even better for Christ. Because I don't want to lift my eyes up in hell, then look up and see y'all having a good time. And when I know I could have had that good time if I only just did right.
Man, that's something to think about.
That thought of depart from me. Woo. Work is iniquity.
Yes, sir.
I have no party because of the way we act.
Come on now.
Because of the way we do, the way we treat people down here on this earth.
Yes, sir.
We have that opportunity.
Yeah.
And it's a golden opportunity if you decide to do what thus says the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm fresh on that thing, sir.
Amen. So those of you that's watching, wherever y'all watching around the world, think about that, especially if you know your soul ain't right with God. Imagine if you die and you don't know Christ, and He give you the glimpse of heaven, which you could have had only if you'd have just lived right. that just add on to your torment. And so, if you don't want to experience that, I plead with you, get to know Christ. Get to know Him as your personal Savior. Oh, the question 9, the great anguish, Luke 16:24. That celebration says, since the rich man was able to see Lazarus being comforted. Amen. When we read that again, it said, since the rich man was able to see Lazarus being comforted, he down there. Probably losing his mind or losing whatever at the feeling at the time. Seeing that Lazarus is comforted and he's not comforted. Amen. Whatever, Hades, whatever's going to go on in Hades, the Bible tells us, ain't nothing comforted about that. And so when you look up and see that you're uncomfortable and see that you could have been comfortable, amen, his plea was with the Patrish, I'm going to pronounce it right, to send the former beggar, Petrarch. Okay, to send the former beggar to his aid. His request was simple. He wanted Lazarus to deal. The tip of his finger is a nugget in there, y'all. I'm about to hopefully point out. He wanted Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in some water and cool his tongue with a few drops. Now, the nugget in there, I found out, he wanted a few drops of water from Lazarus, but Lazarus couldn't get a few drops of crumbs from him. Yes, sir.
Still one pastor.
Yes, sir. And so you weep what you sow. The Bible says the same measure you give out will come back to you again. Amen. That's good or bad. You weep, if you sow good, you'll weep good. Amen. You sow nasty, you sow backstabbing, you sow crookedness, you sow underhanded. That's what's going to come back to you. The same message you give out is going to come back to you. Amen. Well, you saying, well, preacher, as far as I know, I try to do everybody right. I try to treat everybody right. I try to do this and that. But things still happen to me. Well, I'm glad you brought that to my attention. Things going to happen to us. I mean, we're gonna be upright all we can. Things gonna happen to us. If you don't believe it, ask Job. Amen. Job didn't do nobody no harm. But, amen, it was his time that he had to let his faith be in action. When the devil came to Jesus and said, hey, I bet he'll curse you and die if you just let me get to him. Amen. But Job showed the devil, hey, my trust and my faith is in God. And that's what we got to do. Amen. That's what we got to do. Have our faith and trust in God. So, this lets you know that you got to watch how you treat people. Watch how you treat people. The same person you laugh at because they broke now might not always be broke. Because the Bible says the last shall be first. Amen. It says, for the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. So watch how you pick at people, how you laugh at people because of what they got on. Because God is the only God I know. With a snap of a finger, you can be broke one minute, and next minute you can be filthy rich. God is the only man I know to make a way out of no way. God is the only man I know clouds can be hanging on your life right now, but in just a speakable word, clouds can be gone and the sun shining in your life. God's the only one I know to bring you from bankruptcy. Amen. About to lose your house, lose your car, and just speak of something and say, and speak well done. You know that it's going to be all right. Amen. He's the only man I know that can do that successfully. Successfully. Amen. Since the time, the great tragedy. It says, since Lazarus could not leave paradise to aid him in his torment, the rich man made another request. Isn't this something? All this request, all of a sudden, man, you got so many requests for Lazarus. And Lazarus just wanted you just give for him his crumbs off his table. My. Isn't that something how God can turn the tables on somebody, on the enemies? Amen. Well, so those of you that feel like every time I go to work, somebody always ridicule me. They always seem like they're setting traps for me. They're always doing this for me. I got family members, church members. They're always doing this and that for me. Just stand still. God's fighting your battle. Amen. God is fighting your battle. They might end up like the rich man, needing you on down the road. Amen. So you just hold your peace and let God fight your battle. It says, he pleaded Lazarus that he might be able to return to earth for those purposes of warning the rich man's unrepentant brothers. Well, nothing else is said about these brothers. They too must have pursued selfish, ungodly lives. Amen. All right, particular points. It says when we have the opportunity, we should help those who are in need. Luke 16:9-21, Galatians 6:10. Number two, when we are in turmoil, the slightest suggestion of kindness can be a great relief. Luke 16:22-24. Number three, one day all people will be held accountable for their actions. Verses 25-26. I don't care who you are, from the White House to the poor house, we all will be accountable for our actions one day. Number four, we should tell our loved ones about Jesus while we still can. Verses 27-28. Amen. That crackhead, that prodigal son or daughter. Amen. That selfish family member, that drunk family member. Amen. That family member that they got it all together. We got to get him the word of God. Amen. We shouldn't let it be said that we didn't try to win their souls to Christ. Number five, the word of God contains everything we need to know about salvation. Verses 29-30. Number six, if a person's heart is closed off to God, the greatest miracle will have no effect on him. Verses 31. Amen. Thank y'all for joining the Sunday School Lesson here at Holy Trinity, right? Holy Trinity New Beginning. If you come back in about an hour or two, I'll be coming back preaching. Amen. Preaching the Word of God. Stay in the race. So I want you to come back a little bit later and hear me preach under God's anointing. Stay in the race, because a lot of times, amen, we in the race, but we won't stay in it. So I want you to come back a little bit later, amen, and hear the word of God. Stay in the race until we meet again.